In recent days, some are calling for a return of the so-called Fairness Doctrine, which would force broadcast outlets to air opposing views on controversial issues. And it sounds like a good idea. After all, who could be against fairness? But the reality is something different altogether.
In Washington, D.C., naming your political battles is half the battle itself. So they were very clever to call it Fairness Doctrine.
Dr. Frank Wright is the president of the National Religious Broadcasters.
Americans are famously in favor of being fair, being open-minded and equal-handed. And so who's against being fair? But it's a misnamed doctrine altogether. I don't know what it should be called. Perhaps it should be called the censorship doctrine. Perhaps it should be called what it is, government control of speech.
Instituted in 1949 and rescinded by the FCC in 1987, the so-called Fairness Doctrine supposedly preserved a diversity of views on the limited public airwaves. But critics point out that it actually silenced many voices and now seems to be aimed at squelching one medium in particular, talk radio.
Reinstatement of the Fairness Doctrine would effectively shut down talk radio as we know it, and would shut down a lot of Christian radio as well, because you'd have government bureaucrats monitoring content and determining whether they think there's enough opposing viewpoints to air against those that the Christian and talk radio stations want to air. And a lot of station managers would say, this is too difficult, it's red tape I don't need.
Robert Knight, senior writer and correspondent for Coral Ridge Ministries, is the author of Not Fair, Not Free, the Fairness Doctrine Campaign to Crush Free Speech.
All this talk about the Fairness Doctrine points to one thing, eliminating the one major media outlet that is conservative, that's pro-life, pro-marriage, pro-family. You don't find these kinds of views ordinarily on all the other media, from cable television to broadcast television to major newspapers to news magazines.
Without question, Christian and conservative voices have multiplied, especially in talk radio, over the last couple of decades. So is there a pressing need to make sure those views are balanced by competing opinions?
Here's the flawed premise of the Fairness Doctrine. It's that balance is needed, that somehow Christian and talk and conservative talk radio need to be balanced because they're dominating the media when they're only a tiny slice of the media. Here's the media universe. You've got 1,400 daily newspapers out there, and the large majority of them are liberal. You've got three major news magazines with a combined circulation of 9 million. They're definitely liberal. ABC, CBS, and NBC are decidedly liberal, and they attract 23 million viewers every evening to the three evening news shows. They also attract a combined 13 million to their morning news and talk programs. So you're talking about 40 million viewers. In terms of radio, you have National Public Radio with 860 stations around the country with a weekly audience of anywhere from 23 to 26 million people. And so the idea that talk radio has to be balanced by law, the government has to come in and make sure there's enough representation of liberal viewpoints on talk radio is patently absurd.
As many critics of the media point out, rather than needing to be balanced out, Christian and conservative broadcasting is the balance, with the rest of the mainstream media being largely biased against such viewpoints.
Over the years, studies by the Pew Research Center and other academic institutions have revealed that when journalists describe their own views, they're consistently to the left of those of the American people. One of the later surveys in 2007 showed that journalists were 97% pro-choice on abortion. It's 97% in a time when America as a whole is becoming more and more pro-life.
The nature of bias isn't some big bad conspiracy. It's groupthink. The media elites live in a very comfortable elite liberal bubble, basically in New York and Washington.
Bernard Goldberg is the author of the book Bias. He saw the tilt of the mainstream media firsthand during his 28 years as a CBS News correspondent.
Inside the bubble, it's very comfortable because you don't find anybody who basically disagrees with you on these issues. And this has become the norm in the elite newsrooms of America, this liberal outlook on things, whether it's the New York Times or the Boston Globe or the LA Times or the papers in Chicago or ABC News or NBC News or CBS News.
The mainstream media also seems to be largely devoid of Christian perspectives, despite the fact that more than 70% of Americans, in one recent poll, identify themselves as Christian.
I worked in several newsrooms on both coasts for 15 years, and I met very few people who were either regular churchgoers or conservative.
There is a new Sarah Palin impersonator in town.
Journalists themselves describe themselves as not particularly religious. They don't go to church on a regular basis. Well, you say, well, why is that? Well, because it isn't important to them.
I want to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
And that's why when you see conservatives and Christians in particular quoted in the press, they're approached as if they're in National Geographic and the intrepid reporter is going into some remote village and finding some bizarre ceremony or statement that they can use to shed a little light on this alien culture.
But while the need for a change in government policy is doubtful, and though the president and many prominent politicians now claim to oppose the Fairness Doctrine by name, critics warn that it will still be propagated under other guises.
Both houses of Congress, the House and Senate, have signaled that it's time to reimpose the Fairness Doctrine because we don't like what we see with conservative and Christian talk radio or conservative and Christian broadcasts on television. Everyone needs to understand when they hear the words Fairness Doctrine, there's nothing fair about it. It's neither fair nor constitutional, nor is it wise public policy, and certainly from the standpoint of personal freedoms, especially First Amendment freedoms, very unwise to allow the nose of the government camel in that tent, because pretty soon you're going to have the whole beast in there with you.